Okay, I want to thank the organizers for having asked me to talk here. And okay, in practice, I've been asked to give a small introduction, but okay, I will try to be shorter than what they hoped to. On me. Okay, so we know that the background fields have to be introduced in several theories, and one can introduce even where they are not needed. But so we know that there are theories essentially like gauge theories, where we usually want to have a computation with effective action in using the background field method. And this in order to deal some way with gauge invariance. And gravity is one of these theories, but the background is needed even for other reasons. For example, we need a notion of a scale, and Jan also has described this. And also in cases where you have non-linear theories, it may be important to introduce a background. For example, if you want to have a geometric approach where since your fields live in some manifold. And then, for gauge theories, doesn't work? Okay. A short comment again on the problems. Okay, we have a background field method, so essentially we will have the presence of two gauge fields, and in this case we have, as Jan has also said, some Slevno-Taylor identities. Because they are modified in the functional RG approach because we have an infrared regulator. We have the presence of the background, and the dependence in the background is described by the modified splitting world identities. And these are indeed very complicated, and the engaged theories, it's very difficult to deal with them. Actually, they are related these identities in some ways, okay, because in some sense the degrees of freedom in gauge theories, since some of them are spurious in some sense, are not physical, could be disentangled with some non-local field reparametrization, and this means that there are some relations. For gravity, we know that it is a gauge theory. We have all these problems, and what we really be concerned is that physics should be independent on the background. So whatever background we use, we should get the same result, and this is a very hard point in this game. And also the double field dependence is technically giving an enormous problem, because in practice, when we want to study an effective action and we plug in the vector equation to study the flow and the fixed point structure, eventually we need to make ansatz on the truncations, and there are, with two fields, many possibilities and a lot of operators that can appear in the truncation, which may be relevant, and they are constrained by these identities we're talking about. And it is very, very difficult in this case to deal with this. So we know, indeed, that what one is doing is trying to separate a first piece from this effective action where the full matrix G is essentially coincident with the background plus corrections. And these corrections, which contains also, let's say, all the real structure of this action depending on the two fields is really containing a lot of information which we should not miss, essentially. So we have, let's say here, for example, as Jan was showing, all the vertex expansion is hidden inside here. And we know that even if we try only with this approximation or with the studies about the flow of the vertices, which give useful information, we know that we get the same picture that asymptotic safety seems to be there, but there are a lot of disagreements, and so these approximations clearly show that we are not keeping them under control. The other interesting field of application that I was saying was a nonlinear sigma model. Here, let's say we have normally a non-trivial manifold. So let's say there are different possibilities. O1 as an effective theory computes S matrix elements, and then one does not need anything special. One can introduce any background, but the fluctuations around any background are enough to compute, let's say, some physics. Otherwise, if you want to work with an effective action, which is an off-shell quantity, one should be careful because, of course, this, in some sense, depends on the parametrization heavily. And if you introduce a background, then you have a double field dependence, of course, and geometrically you implement a double field description in terms of a base point in the manifold plus some vector which permit to develop, for example, a geodesic along this manifold. And so the point is, again, we have here a problem of a two-field dependence. So, okay, then after this small introduction, let's say that what I will present here, it's a much simpler attempt to solve a very small problem, which is related to theories which are not gauge theories, and also we concentrate on a special class of splittings which are not the most general that one can encounter, for example, in gauge theories, which essentially mix in a very non-local way the different fields. This is the point. So we will try to stick with some background fluctuation splitting, which are local. And okay, so this is the starting point. Let's say that here there is also a small a view of the functional RG approach. I can define the effective average action in this way. So the red part here is essentially the infrared regulator. If I remove it, I have the standard approach in quantum field theory, and the regulator is here. And xi bar is the average fluctuations, so it is essentially what is called the classical field. And one can consider that this field is generically splitted in a background and a fluctuation. And we consider that these fluctuations should be a vector in order to have a covariant description. And so if one has this splitting, automatically one can only taking a derivative with respect to the background in this equation get this modified splitting word identity. So it is here written essentially this part, which depends on the background, is very easily on the regulator is very easily understood, because when one takes a derivative with respect to the background, this goes inside, let's say, in the integration with the derivative, and clearly corresponds to a contribution with a quantum average. And then, of course, one taking a derivative with respect to the scale can get the better equation, and these modified split word identities are compatible with the flow. So if, essentially, if this object here is zero, it will also its variation will be zero and maintained along the flow. So it is a consistent relation, in some sense. Okay. Okay. So let's consider first a case where we consider only the standard quantum field theory with no infrared regulator. So we don't consider RG flow here. So the splitting word identities were written in this way. And one can ask, which kind of solution are here possible to be derived? And it's very difficult. One can see immediately that if the variation of the fluctuation with respect to the background in order to keep the total field fixed is done, one can expect locally an expression of this kind. And this means that when you take the quantum average, you will have a complicated functional of the action. So it will be very, very let's say, a very, very complicated non-local structure. There is one case instead when this is possible to be solved. It's just when one restricts to splittings containing only these two terms. And so if we take this kind of structure, the most generic structure for this multiplet, then one can see that plugging this inside here, one gets this constraint for the effective action. And then this can have a solution if the integrability conditions of Frobenius are satisfied. So it essentially it's a PDE to be solved, and the solution can be obtained solving these two equations, where here in a compact notation we have introduced some tensor forms, one forms. So the solution is given by these objects, and so the components are here. And from these solutions, one can immediately obtain the dependence of the total field on the fluctuations and on the background. Indeed, one can plug inside, let's say, this equation. The objects, and get this relation, which can be trivially integrated to be this. So, essentially, the total field is a function, arbitrary function, of the sum of a function of the background plus a linear transformation of the vector given by this matrix. And in particular, if let's say F is not singular, we can always identify G with the F and get this this expression. So this, for the case where one redefines Xi to make U becoming this, so the derivative with respect to the background of this function F, this becomes an exponential map. Essentially can be written in this way, And this gamma are the covariant derivatives of the connection with respect to the lower indices. And essentially, the connection is this. So it's really depending on this function, which defines the splitting, essentially. Okay. And in this way, we can write a very special solution, which is single field dependent, for an arbitrary, splitting defined by a function f in that way. One can also plug back inside the definition of the effective action this, and one can rewrite all in this way. So one can see that indeed this effective action is a function of a single field. And one can see that if you reparameterize the background here with an arbitrary function h, you reparameterize the quantum fluctuations accordingly with the gradient of h, and redefine f in this way and u in this way, the relation which was given here essentially is corresponding to the transformation of H. So this is clearly a covariant approach, in some sense. And one can check that, for example, at one loop, which is very similar to what we will need after for the functional RG, one can compute essentially with a standard trace log formula, the one loop effective action correction, and one needs the second functional derivative in the fluctuations here of the action. And so taking these expressions, one at the end can write the second functional derivative in the quantum fluctuations as the second covariant derivative in the background times these functions. And essentially, if one is computing the trace log part, one can get rid, because of the measure in the path integral, of the other factors, and essentially get this formula, which is what is well known indeed also in the Wilkowiecki approach, in some sense. And what is important here? So since it is single field dependent, I can compute, for example, with the background, and after introduce automatically classical field dependence, and I have it at all orders automatically, let's say, of course. Okay, and for the symmetries, there is something to be said, of course, because here we have, constructed a splitting based on some connection which is flat, which was defined here. And so this means that indeed one can make a transformation to a reference system where this connection becomes zero, of course. And if we have an action and it's very complicated and described by many tensors inside, let's say that when we make a transformation of the fields, we transform covariantly the action. And if we want that this transformation is a symmetry, the action should become the same. So we need this identification. And also that the extra dependence on the connection is not there. So also the connection should not be modified. And this means that if I go to the reference frame where this is zero, the transformation of this connection which is given by this term should be zero. And this means that in that frame, one should have a transformation of first order in the fields, which also include the linear transformations. And so this means that if we have some symmetries in the action, these symmetries should be linearizable. That means that there exists some reference frame in which I have a linear representation for these symmetries. And these symmetries, let's say, when can be linearizable? Okay, there is already a well-known lemma due to Coleman, Vess, and Zumino, which tells that if the action is generated by the action of some group acting on the manifold of the fields, we need essentially one should check if there is a fixed point in this manifold. And this means that if there is a fixed point around this point, I can find a system of coordinates where the action is linear. And what is interesting is that this fixed point, in principle, can be also outside the manifold if we are interested only in the local properties of transformations that we can have in another coordinate system, not the one which is where the linear action is, let's say, realized. And so, in some sense, we have a possibility that one can, for example, having a manifold, extend it in order to include the fixed point, and which would be under the action of H, and then prove the existence of a linearizable symmetry. Or otherwise, in a case where this is already the case, one can remove it. And so there are cases where this can happen, and one of them, for example, is a nonlinear sigma model, where, for example, with the addition of one extra field going to the cylindrical manifold, one can see that there is a fixed point that can be realized at infinity. And this means that, for example, one can study models like the battery is over. Okay. One can study models as this one, and for example, setting the function f of h in front of the metric of the nonlinear sigma model to a constant. This means that this theory, in reality, as H and the nonlinear sigma model completely decoupled, and then the physics of this model contains in a separate sector the physics of the nonlinear sigma model. And then I can study this. Okay. A little bit. You mean that it was the finger? Ah, okay, sorry. And okay, so this is the example that I wanted to show. And then for the effective average action, in some sense, we one very simple possibility is to consider a solution, okay, where we take advantage of the solution given before, and we search for solutions which make the modified splitting world identity to be satisfied in the presence of the regulator, setting to zero also the other contribution. And so this, what does it mean in practice? That I would have a reparametrization invariant effective action at any scale. There is a flow, and the reparametrization is scale independent, and so this, let's say, single field dependency maintained along the flow. And how this is done? Okay, it is possible to set let's say, transform this part to this, adding in both terms and subtracting connection term. This make this relation completely covariant. Then if I use the solution at the quantum field level without regulator, I see that this covariant derivative is constant, so this term becomes zero. And then we need only to set this to zero. And this is constructed in this way. So it is possible to find a regulator which is background dependent, such that this term, which is the covariant derivative of the regulator, is zero. And with this, essentially, and I stop here, let's say, one can construct a flow based on the second fluctuation derivative, which is given here, and where let's say these U terms are cancelled in the ratio of the, inside the trace, and one can even redistribute these factors F minus one, which are the dependent on the total field, in inside a new cutoff term, let's say, and write in a manifest way this flow as a field, a single field dependent. And for the symmetries, all the things are the same. So in practice, if I use this equation to study the flow, I can see immediately that I can have a single field dependent. So this means that I can use the background field approximation to compute the action, and then rise to a full field dependence, including the classical field. And I can see for example, if I have a solution which I consider in LPA, a fixed point of the flow, of course, by reparametrization, this will appear as some second order in the derivative expansion object. Because, of course, for example, if in one frame, let's say, if I fix jk to 1 in the LPA and I make a reparametrization, this j will not be anymore 1. And so this will show that the equation for the flow are covariantly transforming, and the solutions can be found at the same level of approximation in any reparametry, in any frame of the fields, in some sense. Okay, and only to show you a few examples. Okay, here there is an exponential parametrization, and one can study with this connection. If I have a polar coordinate system for an ON model, or in this case O2, I can use these splits, and this in the expansion I have, of course, the connection terms here and here, and one can deal with all these models in a nice way. Unfortunately, these are very simple models in some sense. The only maybe interesting thing is this possible application to nonlinear Sigma models, but gauge theories and gravity are instead a very hard problem. And there are proposals. We will see.
Thank you very much. Okay.